placidly amid the noise and haste. And remember what peace there may be in silence. As far as possible, without surrender, be on good terms with all persons. Speak your truth quietly and clearly. And listen to others, even the dull and ignorant. They too have their story.
In the middle of the earth, in the land of Shire, lives a brave little hobbit whom we all admire. With his long wooden pipe, fuzzy woolly toes, he lives in a hobbit hole and everybody knows him. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, he's only 3 feet tall. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, the bravest little hobbit of them all. Now hobbits are peace-loving folks, you know. They're never in a hurry and they take things slow. They don't like to travel away from home. They just like to eat and be left alone. But one day Bilbo was asked to go on a big adventure to the caves below to help some dwarves get back their gold that was stolen by a dragon in the days of old. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, only 3 feet tall. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, the bravest little hobbit of them all. Well, he fought with the goblins. He battled a troll. He riddled with Gollum. A magic ring he stole. He was chased by wolves, lost in the forest, escaped in a barrel from the Elf King's halls. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, the bravest little hobbit of them all. Back in his home in the land of Shire, that brave little hobbit whom we all admire, just sitting on a treasure of silver and gold, a puffing on his pipe in his hobbit hole. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, he's only 3 feet tall. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, the bravest little hobbit of them all. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, he's only
3 feet tall. Yeah. So, yeah, we decided to open it up with this song, ladies and gentlemen. So, and we have Mr. Brayton to blame for that, but I fully support his creative opening decisions. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the live watch of the 1977 version of Rankin-Bass The Hobbit. Yeah, I almost called it the Two Towers. Let's bring in our guests. First off, we have Mr. KaijuNoir himself, Andres.
We don't want to go to stream today, but the Raf of the mountain said nay, nay, nay.
The show, I can't add to it, okay.
Where there's a stream, there's a way.
Where there's a stream, there's a way.
Left, say, left, right.
The Lord of the Crap says, we're gonna say stuff through the movie anyway or else. Okay, we're done there.
J.R.R. Tolkien, insane dominatrix.
Well, there was a reason he had all those hedges and bushes covering up the windows at his house, and the hippies were always trying to get in. So. Okay, so
he had good shit on him.
There's a reason why Sauron hated Gandalf for smoking the Hobbit weed.
And there's a reason the
Balrog's lettuce.
And there's a reason Bones hated Mr. Spock too. That fucking song, it wouldn't end.
Bilbo Baggins,
the strongest little thing. Yeah, it's actually a pretty good song.
This little midget in the woods.
It's actually. Oh wait. Okay. So. Okay, we'll talk about that song in a minute. But next up, we have Mr. Brayton.
I'm Thorin. Thorin where? Thorin here, my ear. I think I have an infection.
Get behind me, baby king.
All right, and also join us tonight is Mrs. Wyn the Rogue.
Hello.
Hi. So,
Mrs.
Sorry.
Wait,
what? What? No. Darn it.
Getting married?
Yeah. No, I. Sorry, I should have.
Or did you?
Yeah, did you? Tell us the secrets, girlfriend.
I think they expanded that one tiny chapter in your diary into a 3-hour movie. I think by Peter Jackson.
Elijah Wood was there.
I told you shouldn't have given away the movie rights, Wyn.
Yeah. So
I don't even remember doing that. But last thing I remember was being at the Green Dragon telling my bardic tales, as apparently I am the bard.
Yes, indeed. So, yeah, let me switch the title card briefly to show off our hobbit personas. So, okay, we have... go on.
I was going to say, 1 minute I'm telling my tale, I'm rewarded with a handsome drink that I'm still... baffled is considered a pint given how big it was.
Mm-hmm.
Next thing you know, I don't remember a damn thing.
Yeah, I think some pillows were assassinated in the hotel across the streets.
Yeah, I get pretty stabby when I'm drunk.
Okay, and let's see who's in the chat. We have Laura Fitkin. She says, yes, I love this song. By the way, guys, we should keep it as PG as possible tonight. and then we have Goji Shea 1999 saying, I should have known we were subjected to this song. So, and then Laura follows that up saying, can we just listen to this on a loop? No, Laura. So, all right. And we have Doomzilla saying, good evening, everyone. So, all
right,
so...
Do you think there's, like, a trap hip-hop remix of this song out there? There's gotta be, right? Like, Bilbo, Bilbo, You know, something you can twerk to? I don't know.
Yeah, I guess so. So, and ladies and gentlemen, if you have any questions for us, go ahead and put it in the chat. We'll do our best to read them throughout the night. Although, when we... Okay, so here's what's gonna happen. When we are... Bum-bum-bum.
When we're bum-bum-bum.
When we
rup-a-bum-bum.
Yeah, when you see when the main title card gets a little dark with Smeog's glowing eyes, you know we'll be watching the show itself. But right now we're doing a pre-show, and those usually last about 30 to 40 minutes where we just kind of chill and talk about stuff and let other people come on board. But we decided to start a little early for various reasons. But let's look at our Hobbit personas, designed and drawn by yours truly and incorporated by Brayton in the main title card. So, first off, we have me, of course, as Gandalf, betrayed through...
Gandalf the Weird.
Yes, Gandalf the Weird. It's basically my Crimson Weirdo character in the role of Gandalf, and his staff is more than just mere wood. It's also the staff of cheapness, which is now an unofficial character in its own right. Okay, behind the Crimson Weirdo... wearing his little dwarf crown is
my little Burger King hat.
Yeah,
that I got that wrapped around my head. Uh-huh. Do they still have those? I haven't been to Burger King in about 45 millennia.
I think
so. I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't know if they still brand themselves that way.
No, I think they stopped the kid meal thing long ago. So yeah, there's. I
remember. Didn't they have mood meals like a meh meal and a. Or was that McDonald's? I can't remember. They tried some weird marketing thing a while, but I know they changed their logo back to the retro-looking one,
mm-hmm.
Where it's just like the red and orange, you know, name between the buns.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I just wasn't sure, you know, if they still gave out Burger King crowns or if they're trying to disassociate themselves from the king, if he, you know. Had any shenanigans go on and had to apologize for it?
Oh, yeah. And there was some controversy with the king. You see, he was freaking creepy.
Yeah. You ever play Sneak King? That's like I played the Burger King video game where you were the Sneak King. You were the Burger King sneaking around people's yards and like picking up hamburger tokens and leaving them on people's doorsteps.
Mm-hmm.
It was the worst.
Okay.
And, you know, games like that are considered problematic these days.
They were problematic those days. It shouldn't have been made. I know they had a
tell me about
race
it.
Car one and
I was gonna say
bumper cars.
Tell me about it. In this capitalist society where we're screwing over the poor, the idea of a video game where you give people free food just doesn't fly anymore.
Nope.
Okay.
Nope.
All right.
Burger King, stone cold Marxist.
Yeah. Okay, and speaking of Marxists, let's get back to the JJR token stuff here. Okay, so Brayton, your alien character, Kono Branzant, is in the Thorin role. What do you think?
Well, he's only an alien to you, and his planet, you would be considered the alien. Even on Earth, you would be considered an alien, right? You're otherworldly.
A member of the Domian Empire from the Domian homeworld, what do you think?
Pretty cool.
Okay.
Very cool. Very,
very cool.
Cool.
Very cool. Okay.
I kind of came up with it. I should take ownership of it being cool.
Mm-hmm.
Even though you didn't, did I come up with Kono Branzant or did you do it as a lark? I can't remember.
I did it as a lark, just playing around with various friends' names. Like Denny Roth was Solodak Rothden, which was a giant dinosaur Solodak. And I don't know. I think other people were, Patrick Galvin was an alien or something.
And this is all against their wishes. Like, yes. You just did this on your own for your own amusement.
Oh, yeah, because their names reminded me of my original.
No longer people.
They're just fictional characters in my eye. But, yeah, I did Kono Branzant. It's like, oh, yeah, if Brayton was any member of my fictional alien races, he would definitely be a Domian, who are silver-skinned Imperius chaps.
Capitalist.
Yeah. No, imperialist. They are just capital, not capitalists. So, but yeah, that's, and I don't know where the design came from, though. Although I know it was you who requested.
It was you who influenced. I ate a whole bunch of you-hoos and drew this in a drunken haze.
Nah. It was you who suggested he have silver skin instead of gold, and I think it works out better because. But anyways, yeah. That
looks less like Adam Warlock and more like...
I was
like,
just about to say that.
Yeah. We're trying to make him look even more amazing, like Ziggy Stardust, than he does look right now. So, all right. Now, I kind of cheated because Wyn's such a big fantasy fan, and she's kind of suffered a lot through her boost persona. We'll explain that in a moment. She gets two avatars above that. She's... Wyn the Rogue, her elven... is it an elf or is it a different character with the green eyes?
Oh, Wyn's an elf.
Yes, okay. Wyn the Rogue, who is an elf thief, but she's taken on the role of Bard, the town's guard. So that's why her outfit is kind of similar to Bard, although the colors are from Wyn the Rogue's earlier outfits. And just because I already had the design for a Boo dwarf, I decided to put Boo in there. She's a little gray alien whom Wyn has voiced in some of our past projects. And Boo's like, wow, who are you? I want to be like you when I grow up. If I grow up.
Holy crap, what a badass.
So what do you think of your two little personas here?
Like I said, I love it. It's really awesome. And I have a confession to make. I may have, on our way to our journey, stolen that bow from Legolas.
Oh, no.
A rogue has got a rogue, and rogues are kind of the thief class.
Exactly, and him and his dad, they hate dwarves and podcasters. So we're in a terrible situation.
It's like, no, Legolas, you're not appearing in this Hobbit.
Okay, so...
And Andres, you can see, gets two representing pictures there, too. And then his dick was Azul and his fursona Spoopy.
Okay.
Fuck you.
Yeah, Brayton, screw you. Okay, so... truth be told, Draco Azul take... KaijuNoir's...
Oh, Laura just said, I will Amazon Prime you a ladder and a 9-volt battery, Wyn.
Oh my goodness. Okay.
So anyways,
the continuing battle of Wyn and the smoke alarm will continue tonight.
You leave that smoke alarm alone. That's the only thing that tells Wyn she's in danger.
I don't want Gilbert Gottfried to be upset.
I just want to tell her that she needs to clean my batteries. Haven't you ever heard of being cool about fire safety?
Oh no, Gilbert Gottfried.
Remember these promos when Gilbert Gottfried voiced a smoke alarm?
When he smells smoke in the air, he tweets about Japan. So you gotta
And wound up out of work for at least 5 years.
Yep. Oh my goodness. Yeah.
I mean, Fukushima would you prefer comments. That or would you prefer that or George Costanza?
Okay. So anyways, getting off of that immaculate impression of Bilbo Baggins done through Gilbert Godfrey, we have KaijuNoir as his Draco Zul character as Bilbo Baggins.
Robo Baggins.
No. The Robit.
The Robit.
Yeah, so, which, I hate to say, I think miniature version?
Draquito Azul.
Draquito Azul looks very dashing in the Hobbit clothes there.
And the scarf just sells it perfectly, I think.
Exactly. So I do have one regret. I don't know why I put a wristwatch in his coat pocket there, but he still looks good, so what the hell. So they had watches back in Middle Earth, right, guys? Right?
Did they?
It's
Tolkien. Yeah. They had mixed times back then, after all. Most of the Uruk-hai were made with machinery in a very medieval context, yes, but still machinery nonetheless.
Thank you, Wyn. You just made myself feel better about my creative decisions here.
I'm a Tolkien nerd.
Yeah. Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, now mentioning it, considering how J.R.R. Tolkien dressed, yeah, I think Andres is also playing the role of J.R.R. Tolkien. He's like...
So speaking of weird items, why does Gollum have a giant ring from Sonic the Hedgehog?
Because it's a giant ring from Sonic the Hedgehog. I just thought that was funnier.
Okay,
yeah. And that's supposed to be the Rankin-Bass version of Gollum, hence the reason why he looks way more toadish or froggish than he does usually. Although granted, I'm not too thrilled about the way he came out. Like, it's okay, but it's not 100% accurate to the original version. None of these characters are 100% accurate to their original versions.
You're pretty accurate.
Yeah, I'd say so. Of course, the artist would portray himself the best in the best lights.
Yeah! One more time. Just one more.
Okay, yeah, but those are our characters. Oh, wait, Andres, what do you think of your little Drickle-Zool there?
Very cool.
Yeah,
very cool.
Yeah, I was almost going to get rid of Gollum here, but then all you guys told me, no, leave him, he's cute, so.
He is kind of adorable in a derpy way.
Yeah, exactly, so.
I don't remember telling him that.
Did one of our little characters you created speak to you, Raf, from the pages?
Not now, Brayton, I'm talking to Brayton the paper puppet. What's that?
Oh no, I'm in flipbook form. Flip the pages really fast, and I do jumping jacks.
Oh, no.
Something doesn't do in real life. None of us do that in real life. Okay, so I'm going to go back to our pre-show title card. So say goodbye to your little personas, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Later.
Okay. And there they go.
See you later, alligator.
Okay. And let's see, what else
That's from the Power Rangers movie.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, and ladies...
Let's never do a commentary on that.
Oh, that's a shame, because I wanted to do Turbo, a Power Ranger movie, and see what happens.
If we do, warn me in advance. I don't drink often, but I'm gonna need booze.
Oh, yeah, definitely. So, okay.
That'll be the one-year anniversary of our Mighty Morphin movie commentary, whenever that was. You can watch whatever it is, and I'll have another psychotic episode.
I'm sure it'll come out around the same time as Raf's Singular Point review that we did like months and months and months ago.
And already you've soiled this entire evening. Thanks for nothing, KaijuNoir. Okay, so moving on. This is my show. I have the mute button, so remember that. I can put any of you in timeout. So except you, except Wyn and Brayton, because
you underestimate my power.
You were the chosen ones. You're either with me or against me. Only in show.
I hate you.
Yeah, just step over every line of his in that movie with Andres's like unsure delivery.
Okay, so by the way, the Singular Point review will be coming out, but it's going to be in after Christmas is over because I got bigger projects to do, right, Andres? Winkity wink, mm-hmm. wink. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So yeah, the title card for that can wait a little bit longer.
But didn't Laura already edit it for you?
Yes, she edited the audio, but I'm still got to do the title card, and I want like various screen captures.
Just put a picture of sexy anime me on it and say, boom, there's your title card. I was in that show. They stole my likeness.
And for whatever reason, they gave you an Indian daughter.
Wait, you're married to a woman?
As long as it's fantasy, whatever.
Okay. Yeah, we never saw the mother, okay? So who knows what's going on with anime Brayton?
Our people can adopt, Raph.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Okay, sorry about that. So
wait, if the mother's in the picture, does that mean he's anime Brayton and Disney Brayton?
Oh, no.
Well, I mean, if
I'm scared, I'm moving on. Stranger danger.
Anyways, okay, let's see what we got going on in chat. Okay, let's. Laura says, "Yay, Brayton's alive!" In reference,
we gotta say like Brian Blessed.
Yeah, Brayton's alive.
In reference to my episode a couple of nights ago where I was almost burgled by the Hamburglar.
Oh, you don't have to share that tonight. But
I'm not gonna share. I'll share it on a future stream when there's more hindsight to it.
Okay.
But that was like a weird outer body experience I had the other night.
Yeah, and also
midstream.
Definitely, we were all concerned for you, but we're happy that you're here tonight. Hopefully,
I was concerned for me.
No, we all, like all four of us, was like, where's Brayton? This show isn't nothing without Brayton. I hope he's not
doing,
dead.
Doing my best Shelley Duvall from The Shining impression is what I was doing.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. Okay. By that, I mean, you know, doing the same thing 90 times until I pass out of hyperventilation.
You mean reading fairy tales where Robert Williams plays a frog?
That, too.
Okay. So get that reference. Anyways, oh, Goji Shay. He says, you still don't have the smoke alarm fix, Wyn? Goji Shay, go away.
It's a reoccurring character.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's right. Wyn, since Nippo is no longer with us, Smokey the smoke alarm is our new co-host.
Nippo and Smokey are in the same vocal register.
Yeah. Okay. God, I miss Nippo. He would have been great here tonight.
He could have fit right into the Hobbit.
Oh, yeah, so...
He's one of the characters.
Mm-hmm. So
he could have been Gollum!
Oh, yeah! Okay. Oh, man. All right, Nick Fitkin is in the chat. He says, the Hobbit song is the only good thing to happen to the Hobbit other than this movie. Okay. I'm surprised we got some Hobbit fans here. Okay, and then we got...
Hold on, you're surprised that there are Hobbit fans in a Hobbit live stream?
I thought they were all Silmarillion fans. I'm sorry. It's like everyone knows the Silmarillion. We all grew up with that in class, right? That or my teacher was a huge nerd. So. Morgoth. Anyways. Dooms.
I'm going to murder my smoke detector.
Okay, that's
no. It can act as like a sensor whenever we say something naughty. Why, you son of a? And then wait for it to do it again. Uh-huh.
So that's okay. It sounds a lot less pervasive. That's wrong terminology, I know. Than it was during a Halloween live stream. So yeah, no, I'm okay with your smoke alarm. It gives this live stream character.
Yeah, I kind of, like I said, I kind of moved. I was about to say I moved my microphone just a little bit, so it would be less prevalent. Also, the battery was changed.
Oh, nice!
It's just being a butt.
That's okay. Yeah, so anyway, Doomzilla brings up a good point. He said he had trouble finding this particular animated film, so he decided to sail the high seas. And ladies and gentlemen, I should mention that even knowing you can buy this, you can rent this movie for $3 on YouTube Movies. The link is in the description. There is also some restored versions on a certain public library on the internet that you can also check out the film through. So there are options for watching this. There you go. So, and then what else? Laura Fitkin already, we already did the 9V battery in the ladder joke. So, but then she follows up saying, yeah, have fun tonight. I can't handle the noise. Okay. Oh, Laura, knock
the
it off.
Noise.
So, oh, by the way, this was going to be our post-Thanksgiving live stream, but various things, especially Thanksgiving on my end, kind of got in the way.
Technically, it still is.
Yeah, but, oh, yeah, that is true. But it also doubles as our Christmas farewell, because, Andres, to the best of your knowledge, you're not doing a Christmas show this year, right?
Most likely not, because today's Sunday, mm-hmm. So in 3 days, I'll be flying over to America, and at that point, I'm just going to be busy just, you know, seeing my family for the first time in 2 years, and just enjoying all of that as much as I can for about a week before I have to eventually come back here around New Year's, and then by that time, I'm going to have to do, like, 14 days of quarantine.
Yeah, okay. So,
maybe we could do some live. Yeah, I guess we could do it. Yeah. I guess, yeah, technically, actually, I thought this was going to be tomorrow. So, yeah, tomorrow would be free for me to do like an impromptu Christmas live stream. If you guys, we can talk about this after the fact.
Okay. Yeah. Well, okay, if you want. So, and I'm more than happy to push the pull the ultra trigger to another time. So, we don't need to do it either Sunday or Monday. So.
Or we can do like Ultra Trigger, like we can do my stream after Ultra Trigger.
Oh, yeah, we'll see. Yeah, we'll see what happens. So, quite frankly, okay. I just want to give pull the Ultra Trigger a break this week, even though Abros and Benila are back, and that's kind of a big deal.
Oh, Raf, I'm going to rewatch.
Oh, Brayton, what?
This movie has been on my mind since I'm going to rewatch it for New Year's, but I think I know where you got the Nick and Nora confusion from. Is it from the Thin Man?
Yes,
exactly.
Yeah, no, it will not
only perfect because Nick and Laura would be great in a remake.
No, yeah. Well, no, here's the thing. I got it confused with both The Thin Man, Nick and Nora, but also from the romantic comedy from the early 2000s with Kate Dennings, Nick and Nora's Infinite Playlist. So unfortunately, those two movies and those four characters constantly gets Laura and Nick constantly mixed up in my head. So,
okay.
So from now on, Laura and Nick will only be known as the Fitkins.
Nick and Nora's Infinite Playlist sounds like one of your YouTube playlists of nothing but funk music or something on your channel.
Oh, but I make no regrets. By the way, everybody, if you know me through Facebook and you want some copies of my MP3s from my over 80-hour-long playlists, by all means, contact me. I'll be happy to share.
It's all just Legend of the Dinosaur music. Give yourself 80 hours.
It's either that or all sound effects.
It's not even the full track of Legend of the Dinosaurs. It's just a ba-na-na-na, ba-na-na, looped for 80 hours with occasional yes thrown in.
There's other songs, but I could easily list all the songs in my current playlist. Like, I have a folder for all the songs.
I will easily list them. Legend of the Dinosaurs and Monster Birds. Track one. That's the first one.
You're mean. So, yeah, no. I got the theme song to Space Battleship Yamato. And that's a little... Okay. Oh, Annie Lennox, a Little Bird.
I like Annie.
Yeah. Babass Mass with City Lights. Bay City Rollers, Saturday Night. Abyss with Rollerblade Zero. They're the people who did the theme song for Powerpuff Girl. Bish in Case, the theme song for Godzilla Singular Point. Blues Sara Seno with their funky song Ice Cream, which was featured heavily on when Conan O'Brien and Andy Richter became Ice Cream Men.
Who was that band you were infatuated with for a little while who were dressed like giant rubber aliens?
Oh, a Big Nazo. Unfortunately, as wonderful as their music is, they don't release anything publicly or commercially. You have to go to one of their concerts to actually go buy CDs. So that's why there's such a bereft of musical videos of them. But no,
they're kind of an urban legend that they even exist then, since they just exist through people's fan-taped cell phone footage.
Yeah, and apparently Big Nazo was a fairly well-known band in Europe during the 80s and did a lot of appearances. Well, of course, back then they were just a bunch of ugly human creatures. They decided to go with the more family-friendly, transforming, mutating aliens in the late 90s and to today. But no, it seems to be a band that has, revolving members, because it's actually a creative class head by the creator of A Big Nazo. So, but yeah, we got Bobby Hebb with Sunny.
What is this, the Blue Man Group?
Oh, that's right. You can't tell who's who in that. So we got a whole bunch of original songs from Brandzant Films. Don't know who that is. Brian Ferry with Let's Stick Together, the 88 mix.
You don't have to.
Cass Elliott with Difference. You can. Charles Blaker and Kevin Hyatt with Herald Fanfare.
Can we try to mute him?
Okay, I'll stop.
We engineered the stream yard to mute him.
Yeah, I got back into Chemical Brothers, and that's all I'm going to say. Okay, so... Oh, Goji says, oh my god, I actually do remember those Gilbert Gottfried smoke alarm commercials, Laughing Face with the Crying Tears. Doomzilla says, Robit Baggins? I like it.
Robo Baggins.
No, he said Robit Baggins.
No, but it's Robo.
Yeah.
He's got tiny metal feet, his tiny metal toes, and a long red scarf, and everybody knows.
He riddled with Jack Hoxton.
Why isn't Jack Hoxton?
Yeah, why isn't he Gollum? That would have been perfect.
Damn it. Why wasn't I thinking that? That would have been great.
Missed opportunity.
Yeah.
And all we need for him is to have him be played by Eddie Deason.
Look at me, I'm a genius.
Is Eddie Deason doing better, or is he still...
Fear me, women!
Yeah, that's right. He got fucking, what, arrested for...
For throwing meat at a cop or something in a restaurant.
At a McDonald's or something?
Wait, what?
Eddie Deason, Mandark from Dexter's Lab, and the annoying kid with glasses on from the Polar Express. And there's a bunch of other annoying nasally characters. Yeah, Eddie Deason.
He was Cheese from Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends.
Mm.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Yeah, and he was like, what's his name? Like the magpie from Rockadoodle.
He was in Midnight Madness too, right, Raf?
Oh, yes. The obscure late 70s attempt by Walt Disney to do a Animal House type comedy.
Right.
So, it's not that bad of a movie, so.
But he's bad in it.
Oh, yeah, okay. Actor reportedly threw plates, bowls, and food at sheriff's deputies responding to a disturbance at LaVale, Maryland restaurant.
I'm in Eddie Deason. Never take me alive, copper.
Oh, yeah, he was also in Grease.
Oh, yeah.
He's Eugene... covered in it.
Oh, no.
Okay, so he was yelling loudly and disturbing other customers inside, and eventually police said... had to be forcefully removed from the bench seat / table area where he had holed up. The actor threw numerous items at deputies, including plates, bowls, and food, according to the sheriff's department's news press release. One item reportedly struck a deputy. Deason was eventually arrested and transferred to a local jail to await a court appearance, where he will face the charges of second-degree assault, disorderly conduct, and trespassing.
He's not
suffering from substance abuse. He's turned into a Karen.
This was in mid-September of this year.
Okay, but is he doing better now, or is he still in the
big house? I don't know.
Okay, no, this is, we kind of...
The news never follows up on this.
Oh, yeah, it's like, man found innocent, but we're not going to tell you. So,
don't you know I am? Many Deason.
Yeah, but no, it's just kind of a shame because, we being a child of the 80s, you see him a lot in television and movie appearances, so it's kind of sad to see how the mighty have fallen. He was Mandark too. Oh yeah, that's right. My brother Gabe and I, we were huge fans of Dexter's Laboratory when it originally aired, and we still are to this day. Ego Trip is a fantastic movie, ladies and gentlemen. Track it down. But
it is.
Yes. Oh yeah, yeah. If that was the true final project related to Dexter's Laboratory, the franchise would have ended on a high note, but not that I didn't mind the reboot season they tried doing a couple of years later, but follow-up season, I should say. But no, it's just kind of a shame that somebody you knew from childhood kind of ends up in these bad straits. But yeah, I guess he became a male Karen. So that, or everybody at the restaurant really, really hated Rockadoodle and just got under his skin.
I say, why don't we just put him and Screech from Saved by the Bell in a cage match and see who comes out?
Unfortunately, Brayton, Screech is dead.
Yeah.
Okay, so then Eddie Deason would come out. Then it would be a pretty boring outcome.
Okay, so... Okay.
Ha! I won! All hail Mandark, the genius!
Guys, he can read our minds. We should stop this.
Thanks. I hate it.
Okay. Like I'm going to be afraid of Eddie Deason, even me.
I don't know, Brayton. He has that crazy 80s strength on him.
Yeah, I'm an Adonis in comparison, okay?
Okay. I'm as tough as I sound.
All right. Anyway, enough about the Eddie Deason talking. Let's get back to talking.
And he sounds like nail. I'm tough as nails on a chalkboard, just like I sound.
Right. Okay. Goji. Goji.
He doesn't even talk anymore. He's just making vocal noises.
This is how you sound, Raf, when you do Jack Hoxton. This is your medicine.
I'm Jack Hoxton. Fear me. I throw food at Taco Bell. Ah.
What?
That's right. I'm at Taco Bell, and everyone's bad-mouthing Rocket Toodle.
Where's Steve Carell in Ron Ackerman when you need him?
Loud noises. Oh, God. He was so good in that movie. Anyways, Goji Shay says...
I killed a man.
With a trident. You really should go upstate and hide out for a couple of months. So, Goji Shay says, my library has a copy of the movie, The Hobbit, that I rented, so I'm good. Oh, excellent.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes, and like I said, ladies and gentlemen, in the description you'll find The Hobbit links, wink, wink. Doomzilla says, decided to sail the seas because I refuse to give Google my money. All right, that's totally all right.
Do what you want because a pirate is free. You are a pirate.
Sorry about that. That's a fun song. Yarr. Got into that recently. So,
ahoy, mateys.
Yeah, thanks to you guys, by the way. So, Doomzilla then follows up KaijuNoir's remarks with Robo, Hobo, Dodo, who cares?
Robo Baggins, Hobo Baggins, Dodo Baggins. These all need to be things now.
I know. So, oh God, it's like now seeing that the multiverse is becoming the new big thing in Hollywood, we might get that.
Bobo Haggins.
Yeah. Okay, so in Goji says,
I certainly know what the porn parody is going to be called.
Oh, guys, no, it's bad enough that we're going to watch this movie from the Hobbit hole. We don't need this crap now.
I'm disgusted. I'm revolted. I'm
not sorry. Not the Hobbit hole, Raf. Not a smelly wet hole.
No. Stop!
Those are that's actual that's a line.
I know. Okay, stop, Brayton.
The first line.
Tolkien was high off his ass when he wrote that one. Okay, Goji Shay says Eddie Deason was also in one episode of my favorite Mystery Science Theater episodes, the Laser Blast one. That's right.
And he got blowed up.
Yeah, and he played one of the antagonistic bullies or the toady to the lead villain bully.
Got blowed up real good. Blowed it all up.
And then Goji Shay follows up saying, oh, I remember watching Ego Trip on Cartoon Network's Cartoon Theater back in the day. Great times. Indeed. Mm-hmm. So, okay. So how long have we been going so far?
Too long.
Yes. So we're going to start the show very soon, ladies and gentlemen. Okay. We're going to open up the DVD version in the private chat that Brayton has given us. But like I say, ladies and gentlemen, either have your copies of the movie ready or look into the live stream description for some helpful alternatives. So,
but if you go to the link in the description, you have to sync it up with us.
Oh, yeah, that's right. So
yeah, don't do a self-conscious giggle. You have to sync it up. Tell them how to sync it up. Our version opens on the image of the book.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, and the archive.org link has the little, since it's the VHS version of the movie, has the Warner Brothers, right, home video logo that comes up.
Yeah, but so, the HD version is practically the same as the DVD version, despite the restored audio. I'll mention that when we get to that. But yeah, no, for the most part, we're okay here, so.
Okay. Have you mentioned Smog?
Smog? Wait.
Yeah, it's right there looking at us. Did you mention you drew that too?
Oh, yeah. Okay. So, yeah. So, Smog was a lot of fun to draw, but because of how, I don't want to say complex, but how detailed the design was in the animated series and the kind of art style that we're dealing with. Wait a minute. Well, before I continue, I might as well just put the singular image of Smog I had here.
That's pretty perfect.
Yeah. No. Honestly, like you and Andres and even Miguel and Gabe have all given me props about how Smog looks here. And usually you guys are like, everything you do is terrible.
Trash.
We hate Jack Hoxton and Miss Blue and everything you do. So Jake Tanaka's cool, though.
It's that scene from It's Always Sunny, where it's like, bullshit, bullshit, ah, now this.
Smog was a fan? Anyways.
Yes. What? How do you pronounce Smog? You're Genera-ing Smog, Raph. It's Smog.
It's Smog.
No, Smog. You're supposed to say it like that, not Smog. Smog. Like
it's
you're like meow, like meow, but with an S and a G at the front.
You're
end.
Kidding me.
No, no. I've
there's
I've,
no I.
No, Smog. That's how Tolkien wanted it said. Smog.
Smog. Smog. Smog.
Well, maybe he meant differently, and he just had an accent.
And
did
he was
sneeze
high.
While he was trying. Did he sneeze while he was trying to say it?
You see, when I created the dragon, Smog. It was under a full moon. All right. So, well, we'll just call him Smog.
Smeg. Smeg. It's Smeg.
Is it? No, it's not Smeg. Oh, the U isn't U isn't silent. So, anyway. So,
well, there's no fucking I. I know that.
Okay. So yeah, Smog. Smog. he was a lot of fun to straw, but
Smog.
Yeah, but because of the way the art style was in the animated series itself, and because of the constantly changing details of the creature, I decided to do him in sort of a sketchy form. I do plan on doing a fully inked, recolored, updated version sometime in 2022. But I decided that for this title card, this sort of sketchy look works great for everybody. And also it was a lot quicker way to do it because, again, I got a bigger art project that's more important right now that I'd rather spend more effort on. But, yeah, no, he was a lot of fun to draw. And, I know everyone prefers Benedict Cumberbatch's version of Smog, but I really have come to love this 1977 version, and I'll explain more in a little bit.
The kitty cat version.
Yeah. Well, what's interesting...
Richard Boone version.
Yeah, what's interesting...
Who's given a hell of a Mr. Bad performance here.
Well, okay, so about Smog, I might as well mention it before we get to the movie itself. So, okay, so this movie we're about to watch, the 1977 Hobbit, was done under the same kind of iffy public domain status that King Kong is kind of infamously connected to, which might explain some of the character designs and decisions done for it. And while there's been a lot of official articles written about this film throughout the animation community and magazines, mentioning that the reason Smog looks like the way he does was sort of to combine European dragons with the Asian flair of dragons, I honestly think that, again, it might go back to the copyright situation where they couldn't just do a straight Smog adaptation of the original artwork that Tolkien himself oversaw when the book was originally published. But also I think they were trying to go with a mythological chimera look with the creature, because it's not just a giant cat. There's also elements of the wolf, of course the dragon, and various other creatures in there. So but no, I really do like this character quite a bit, and it matches beautifully with Richard Boone's voice. One YouTuber who did a Council of Geeks, yeah, the host of Council of Geeks, she rewatched this movie a long time ago for one of her videos back when she was a man. And
wow.
Yes. And she mentioned a really good point that Richard Boone's voice acting, it the big difference between him and Benedict Cumberbatch is that Benedict Cumberbatch
Cumberbatch. That's how he meant it to be said.
Yeah,
Benedict Eggs.
Yes. Mr. Cumberbatch, Doctor Strange, he, even though in his voice is very unique, it sounds like he's really stretching hard to try to sound intimidating, whereas Richard Boone, in his just regular speaking voice,
is intimidating.
Yeah, he is intimidating. And it's like, and my brother Miguel, I was talking to him about this earlier the week, I wanted to bring him aboard with the live watch, but he says he doesn't do well around people, especially geeks like Brayton. His words, not mine. It was a joke. He mentioned a good point that Richard Boone's Smog works beautifully because it sounds like what would happen if an omnipotent god had to deal with a mortal directly for a few minutes. So that's why he's completely nonchalant about everything that Bilbo Baggins does. Even, it's like that line he says, it's like, go ahead and help yourself, burglar. There's plenty to go around. Now, Tolkien scholars have said that's because Smog is trying to lure Bilbo Baggins into a trap so he can just kill him right there and then. But when the Richard Boone says it, it really sounds like, yeah, I'm a giant dragon. I really don't give a care. Maybe I'll kill you. Maybe I won't. But who cares? This is my place. Deal with it. So, yeah, I think it works out beautifully and matches great with the design in question. So it's an unorthodox choice for a giant talking fantasy dragon, but I think it works out beautifully. So, and of course, I hate to say this because I'm a giant monster nerd. During doing the research, I discovered that Smaug is 57 meters long, meaning that he could battle the original Showa-era Godzilla, but because of his body proportions, he'd have to be some sort of weird Manda-style puppet. So,
but who would win in a fight between the Smaug and the Spinosaurus from Jurassic Park 3? I got a theory about who would win in the Monsterverse. Smaug.
Yeah. So, but yeah, Smaug is Smaug. Smaug.
Smaug. Take one for God's sake.
Smaug. Smaug.
Smoogie.
Sammy.
Hedra.
Mr. Boone here was a lot of fun to draw, and I really do want to do a picture where it's Smaug versus the Last Dinosaur with regular Richard Boone just pointing in the background like, I'm going to kill both of those guys. So, but yeah, this was a lot of fun to draw, and so far everyone's given it very positive props, including, again, you guys. So, okay, so Mr. Smaug will leave us.
Mr. Boone.
Yes.
Richard Boone was a man. Yes, a drunk man.
Oh, what's going on here? You ding dong.
Go ahead, burglar.
Ugh, have gun, will
I'm
travel.
I'm strong, ding dong.
Doomzilla says 57 meters long. What about height? He's a serpentine like creature, so I think wingspan would.
It's like asking. It's like trying to figure out how high a snake is.
Yeah.
Like you just don't.
Yeah, and it also.
How much can that snake bench?
Yeah. It's Richard Boone. He makes muscles by drinking alcohol. So
he's not Zilla?
Oh no. By the way, Notzilla, a Godzilla spoof, is free on Tubi television, and we recommend it. We had a lot of fun watching at G-Fest.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. But yeah, everyone go ahead to open the links. And Oh yeah, Gojisha says, wow, I watch Council of Geeks too. Yeah, it's a very cool video. And yeah, he brought up some really good points about the voice acting, because the voice acting in this is pretty amazing. They got a lot of really cool, not exactly A-list actor talent outside John Huston himself, who was sort of in like he was still respected as an actor and a name, but he was doing he was basically doing a John Carradine.
Doing a lot of coke.
a John Carradine, and just showing up in pretty much anything he could, including, you know, Italian science fiction movies like The Visitor, which we might do a live watch in sometime this year. So,
yeah, which is, well, that movie has two, you know, very acclaimed legendary directors, John Huston and Sam Peckinpah, and so does this. John Huston and Otto Preminger shows up.
Mm-hmm, yeah,
as my character, right?
Yes. No. You're Thorin Oakenshield. Oh darn it! Hans Conried does the voice of Thorin Oakenshield.
Okay, well that works too.
Yeah. No, Preminger shows up as the King of the Woods Elf, although it's a pretty radical design from what we know Wood Elves to be. But we'll get to that in a bit.
In reality. What else?
In reality, they're mischievous gingers like myself.
Yes. When you control the wood elves? Oh my god, you really do like your Lake Town beer, don't you?
I do not have a beard. Shut up, Raf.
Okay, sorry. Okay, so another thing about the film is that the film was the first major attempt by Arthur Rankin and Jules Bass to leave the holiday specials, alongside The Last Dinosaur, which was originally meant for theatrical release, but they decided to sell it to ABC Television the same year. Whereas The Hobbit animated film was aired on November 27th in 1977 to CBS, which aired a lot of their Christmas specials. And this, you have to keep in account, we did a live watch of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, and that film, we tend to forget, that movie was a huge success on television that not only started the Rankin-Bass series of holiday specials on an almost yearly, if not bi-monthly basis in some cases, but it also just kind of inspired the landscape of Christmas specials for a long while. That's only recently kind of ended or not ended, but kind of definitely you don't see as many Christmas specials as you used to back in the old days. And the ones you do are either spin-offs of existing television shows or spin-offs of existing movies, like the Elf animated special everyone told me is terrible. But yeah, Rankin-Bass, despite their great success with Rudolph, they desperately wanted to kind of wean themselves off Christmas. So
in the you could call that an experiment that didn't work out.
Yeah, well, here's the thing. They had a very successful run because this movie we're about to watch was the first in the fantasy cycle, which was of Rankin-Bass Productions, followed by, in 1988, Return of the King. Then in 1982, you had the 1-2 punch of Flight of the Dragons and The Last Unicorn, both of which I would argue are even better than the movie we're about to watch tonight. And then in 85, their second-to-last Christmas special, The Life and Adventures of Santa Claus, which was more of a fantasy epic than just a simple Christmas special. 85, of course, was also when they had the success with Thundercats. And you can also arguably throw in lesser-known movies in this so-called fantasy cycle, such as The Bermuda Depths, a tragic supernatural love story with a giant turtle in it. Their attempt to do a horror thriller in 83, The Sins of Dorian Gray. And perhaps one of their most least-known films in 1973, which predates The Hobbit, was their first major attempt to try to get out of Christmas television hell. The largely forgotten musical adventure film Marco, which is loosely based on the life of Marco Polo, which, of course, like many of their productions, was also a Japanese-U.S. co-production. So, and that's all I have to say right now before we get into the movie. So, I took notes. But I'm also happy to say that, Brayton, you actually read the book in anticipation.
I didn't finish it.
Oh, God. Don't go to damn me. It.
I had a big last couple of days.
Okay. Oh, that's right. You almost got murdered.
Actually. But no, I've read it once before in my life as a younger man. Oh. And I saw the Peter Jackson's version of it, just the first one.
Okay. All right. We're in iffy waters now.
Yeah. I've never been a fan, frankly speaking, of the Lord of the Rings movies.
Mm-hmm.
I was four when they ended, but even as like a little kid, they didn't inspire really anything in me. Mm-hmm. And I tried watching them as a teenager and still they just leave me. I'm just not a really big hard fantasy fan. Hmm. Like a little more difficult for me to grasp than, you know, The Godfather or something, when it's Orkenschnapf and Fingolfang and Dobby and they're going on an adventure through
just be glad that you're not watching The Black Cauldron with you, when you're going to get all these like Finnish names like Flubengobin or something.
Mm-hmm. The Horn King? Fluter, what kind of weird Fluter, English
no, no,
is
no,
that?
No. Fluterflam. Fluterflam. He was the bard.
Oh, yeah.
These sound like made up names by me to mock Ultraman. Okay. I can't, I just can't get on board. But I like this. This may be the only non-book version of a Tolkien thing that I do like. Because, I just have a low tolerance for the Jackson verse.
Okay. All right. So, Wyn, you are definitely, if you don't mind talking right now, you are definitely the biggest of the fantasy fans amongst us four, right?
Yeah, I do love me some fantasy. I am looking forward to the Rankin-Bass movie because it holds very near and dear to my heart when I was a little kid because it would play quite often on the Disney Channel. Back when the Disney Channel had variety in its movies and wasn't full of vapid first world teenage sitcoms.
That is true. And it's interesting you should mention that because Disney actually released some merchandise related to this version, including a story album. So,
oh shit, for real?
Yeah. So
I just saw in the in like the related videos to this, there's a complete classic audiobook album of this special, 1 hour and 16 minutes on YouTube.
Oh yeah. So as well as the original, it also includes the soundtrack beats, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but yeah. With that, okay. So you grew up with this special like myself on television, right, Wyn?
Okay. Yeah, actually, in the early 90s, when I was a very little kid, it played, like I said, amongst a slew of other very underrated animated films, be it movies I didn't realize were anime, and just some ones that flew off the radar. Okay. Like the 1982 anime movie of The Wizard of Oz. That was also a treat.
Oh, yeah.
I know. So which, if we can find that, we should also do a commentary on that. It was so cute.
I actually have the VHS for that. I made a DVD copy. I think I have.
Yes!
So, yeah. And what's, you know, you want to hear something really funny? The guy who directed that 1982 anime Wizard of Oz movie is Yoshimitsu Bano, the same guy who did Godzilla vs. the Smog Monster.
The Smog Monster. Oh.
So
that's actually pretty awesome. I knew he had a lot of, I knew it would had the style from TMS, which was used for a lot of studios in terms of stuff from the 80s and the 90s, including collaborating to do SWAT Cat season 2. So I wouldn't mind doing a commentary on that sometime, but this is about The Hobbit, so I'm going to get back on topic. But yeah, I really, really loved this film, and when I got older, I did see the Peter Jackson films. I did enjoy them. And in terms of the earlier animated stuff, they weren't too bad, but they weren't as charming as The Hobbit.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I'll quickly mention that, you know, being a child of 80s, much like yourself, Wyn, well, actually, you're a little younger than me, so be grateful for that, as opposed to this old stone giant here who gets scared at rainstorms. Get that reference.
Hey, Raf.
Rainstorm. Oh, my face! Oh, God, I'm going to bash things. Okay. It's not a thunderstorm.
Put me down. Put me down. Help.
Okay, so, no, I grew up with this movie, too, although I don't think I ever saw it on the Disney Channel. It may have played on the Disney Channel sometimes, but I also remember it still playing on regular television. I think it aired once on TBS. Long ago, and of course me and my family used to rent this movie all the time on VHS tape from the library. We had a local video shop we would sometimes rent it from, but that one was Flight of the Dragons Night, which would, we loved that movie growing up. We might even do a Flight of the Dragons, actually, now that we've started this, we could revisit all these animated fantasy films from the 80s nobody remembers. So
I would be all for that.
Oh yeah, definitely. Because I've been trying to get Brayton to see The Last Unicorn. Because as much as Brayton loves this movie, I honestly want to hear what it. I think they perfected the formula Rankin-Bass did.
I don't want to see a backdoor My Little Pony pilot.
The Last Unicorn is such a good movie. Plus, Christopher Lee knocks it out of the park as his role.
No, oh, yeah. So. Okay, but last and definitely not least here, our ring bearer, our burglar, our friend who drowns us and then brings us back, Mr. Andres, what's your opinion of the Rankin-Bass Hobbit, and what's your opinions of just the Hobbit and the J.R. Tolkien oeuvre in general?
So, I've unfortunately never been able to see this movie up until now, and it's always been a movie I've been aware of, but I've never got around to seeing it, only because, unfortunately, the opportunity just never presented itself to me, whether on TV or at the video store or anything like that. Also, I'm someone who was introduced to Tolkien through the Peter Jackson movies, and I grew up thoroughly enjoying them. I guess, unlike Brayton, I do consider myself a pretty casual casual fan of the fantasy genre. And so I'm always in the good mood for any sort of, like, you know, dragons and sorcery, knights and armor and all that kind of stuff. So, like, medieval fantasy settings. I highly enjoy the Peter Jackson movies. Love what he did to them. I know my buddy Dylan, he is a hardcore Tolkien fan, so I'm sure he can talk endlessly about the various adaptations.
Oh my God.
But for me, I just never watched it. I mean, I never watched any other adaptations. I never saw the Ralph Bakshi's Lord of the Rings, although I am pretty interested because I consider myself a general fan of Ralph Bakshi.
Oh, that's a good idea. We could revisit that one.
Fire and Ice, highly recommend.
Ooh, I still need to see that one.
Mm-hmm.
That and American Pop, those two, I all three I have not seen.
Oh, so American Pop is really good. I would argue it's one of Ralph Bakshi's best movies.
So I've heard.
Yeah.
But anyways, I did see the Hobbit movies, the Peter Jackson Hobbit movies as they were coming out. Loved the first two movies. And then the third one was incredibly disappointing just because it felt like such a huge slog of just endless action that didn't have any of the emotional weight that the last Lord of the Rings movie had. So mm-hmm. it didn't had a lot of like Peter Jackson was trying to outdo himself or trying to do what made his Hobbit movie, his Lord of the Rings movie successful. Unfortunately, it only made me realize, yeah, this should have been just two movies. And it's a real shame that we do not live in the timeline where Del Toro was allowed to do what he should have done and not have his project taken away from him and forced into Peter Jackson's laps.
Yeah, and also Lindsay Ellis, she did a really good three-part video about the making of The Hobbit, the Peter Jackson.
Yeah, oh yeah, films. Yeah. Very, very good introspective video about that. Oh
yeah, definitely. But yeah, she gets into the nitty-gritty, the business side behind this ordeal. And yet, in addition to poor Guillermo del Toro not being able to make his version of The Hobbit, I think poor Peter Jackson and a lot of the Weta Workshop crew suffered because of a lot of the behind-the-scenes stuff that was happening with the studio execs, and as you'll see in the third part of her retrospective, with union laws and New Zealand filming rights, period. But that's a whole different mm-hmm. can of worms. Let's get into this one worm hiding out in the Lonely Mountain.
Well, I just want to say, I think I should maybe check myself a little bit and say it's less than I'm not a fan of fantasy and maybe more that I'm not a fan of Peter Jackson. Mm-hmm. Because when I really think, when you bring up Guillermo del Toro, I like a lot of his movies that are mm-hmm. very, like, I love Pan's Labyrinth. Mm-hmm. But I think Peter Jackson just has it's not only that he, like, there's the saying that, well, you can't adapt, you know, a book into a movie because there's just too much stuff to fit in. He adapts a book into a movie, but adds more stuff. Like, he has no, I don't think he's ever been near an editing room. So, though I will say, I am enjoying, I'm only, like, the first, like, miniseries episode into his Get Back series on Disney Plus, the mm-hmm. whole behind-the-scenes Beatles thing, which... Mm-hmm. I'm not a huge Beatles fan, but I've been really, it's incredibly interesting. I'm usually more of a fan of those guys after they broke up, more so, because mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I think they did some of their best work individually mm-hmm. When they were more mature. Mm-hmm. But so, yeah, he's great when it comes to more documentary focused stuff like that, I suppose, for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's just with Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, they went on like forever and mm-hmm. started off like there was the adventure and any excitement that comes along with the prospect of going on this grand adventure was just sucked out to me because I was, mm-hmm. you know, bored when we met the 50th elf princess.
You know, it's very possible that like Peter Jackson is just one of those directors who's just, he's very overindulgent in his own projects where like he doesn't want to see them end. So he just continues to do things because he just enjoys the process of making it. Yeah. Not so much the aftermath of when all is said, done, and shot.
Yeah,
King Kong 2005 for a better example.
I was going to say, it stuns me. There were deleted scenes in Kong's 2005?
Yeah.
It's shocking to me.
Yeah, but, oh, God. You know, it's funny. Lindsay Ellis also did a much more positive three-part retrospective of the Lord of the Rings movies that she utterly mm-hmm. adores. And I agree. I prefer the Lord of the Rings movies more so than Peter Jackson's Hobbit. But she
pretty sure
up...
everyone prefers Lord of the Rings to The Hobbit.
Yeah,
and yes, Laura brings up the wonderful fucked up movie that is Meet the Feebles.
Oh yeah, that's pretty hot. That's my one. Oh,
Meet the Feebles.
She just retracted the message, so I suppose she regretted meeting them already.
Oh God. So I was gonna say though, in Lindsay Ellis's three parts, she had this recurring gag that perfectly explains the problems with Peter Jackson. She called it forced Peege moments, Peege being short for Peter Jackson, where moments in the book that were relatively normal are suddenly turned up to 100 in the extreme factor. Like, you know, it's like Gandalf, you know, coming back to the Shire and asking Frodo if the ring is safe. Instead, he comes lunging out of the darkness. Is it secret? Is it safe? You know, that kind of horrible stuff.
It's funny. I want to play a game with Jackson where I do reviews of his movies by just stating a title of another one of his movies. And I can, my review for Meet the Feebles would simply be Bad Taste, would be my review for that. He did Bad Taste, right?
Yes, he did Bad Taste. He did Dead Alive. He did The Frighteners.
Right. I love Dead Alive.
Yeah. Oh, God.
I kick ass for the Lord.
Oh, you know, the actor who played that priest went on to play Imperius in Power Rangers Mystic Force, the mummy sorcerer.
I'm not surprised.
Yeah.
Poor guy. Hey. I thought that was Paul Frees, Raf.
Yeah, no, shut up.
Yeah.
Paul Frees is in this, by the way, doing multiple That's voice right. roles. So mm-hmm. I'm probably going to... Okay, so let's... Let's
are you sure he was? Are you sure he wasn't? A
ring?
Evans?
I hate rings.
Paul Freeman is in The Hobbit. Damn it! Okay, but yeah, ladies and gentlemen, let's get into it. We'll talk more about Peter Jackson fantasy films in general because I really do want to pick your brains on this. But we're going to start the project. Okay, are you three on 00?
1 hour in. Yes, Raf, I've been on 00 for the last hour.
Okay, excellent. That's okay. We've had a productive talk other than making fun of me, which is always happens on these shows. Okay, so we're going to switch.
Me, that's the only productive thing in these streams.
Yeah, shut up, you little robot. Next time you're Golem. Okay, and we'll get, and don't worry, Doomzilla and Goji Shay, I'm not a big fan of the Hobbit movies, but there are certain elements I do like about it, and Laura seems to like it as well as Andres, but yeah, let's get into it. So, all right.
Hates it forever!
All right, so, everyone are on 00.